Are you now actually finally ready? So, you all begin in the guild hall as usual, although things do not actually start quite the same as normal. Either some of you guys are home at the guild hall, going to sleep for the night, or some of you might actually be out on adventures out in the world. However you guys make your way to your bedrolls or make your way to your spot at the guild hall, when you go to sleep, this sense of peace and ease washes over you. While you are asleep, you get dreams of a far-off place, of maybe a call to adventure, of something bringing you forth out of a deep sleep into a more light dreaming state. As you're doing so, you feel this kind of light, this sense of adventure in front of you that is calling you forward. So what we're going to do for the introductions today is that sense of light is calling you forward. And my question to you is, why do you go for that light? What is your reason for adventuring? Also, those are amazing dice of auspicious fortune. The first thing I need to know is why are you calling towards that light? What part of you is an adventurer that is being called by this force? So, Hannibal, you're up first.
Sure. Well, the last dreams Hannibal had were quite terrible and disturbing. So these feel quite better. And you know, since he's been a habitual heavy drinker lately because of the things he found out, this might be a chance to ease some internal doubts about the way the universe works.
All right, and so give me the normal introduction for your character. What do you look like? Yeah, mechanically, who are you, etc.
Sure. Well, mechanically, tiefling, warlock, student of Kaipon, lots of radiant zones mainly. What he looks like? He looks perfectly human, kind of tall, gaunt. Wears a long leather coat, a staff in one hand, a rod in the other, and another an assortment of rods and daggers from his belt. Disembodied hand, familiar, gray, mottled green, rides on his shoulder. That's the mechanics and what he looks like, yeah.
Cool. Soroka.
Soroka adventures because of two reasons. One, he was put out of work when the adventurers first came to Athos, and he had to find another way to make a living. He has always been a devout follower of the Traveler, and so when the opportunity to go to another world presented itself, that seemed like a no-brainer to him. He can constantly pursue change and exploring new places and following in the footsteps of his own deity by traveling. He has always valued money and looks to secure that now that he's found endless quantities of metal, so that will be seemingly easy to fulfill. Other than that, he just seeks to explore the universe and knowledge. He is a tiny Thrycreen, 5'4", 13 years old, which is kind of middle-aged for Thrycreen. An arena fighter, wields a spike chain, wears hide armor. Well, he's a Traveler's Harlequin, so he has a lot of tricks up his sleeve. Delves into the bits and pieces from other classes. Got it?
Okay, question. I have a question first that is, this light, this sense of adventure, what exactly is it? It just feels like we feeling like entering into a dream sequence or something like that?
User disconnected from your channel.
Okay, fair enough. So, about the reason for adventuring, I guess that Mizuki pretty much feels cornered herself, and she feels like she has nothing that she can do but adventuring at this point. On the other hand, she feels quite a joy in hunting people down, so that sadistic part of her is always satisfied by the hunt. character introduction, I'd say that she's a short, slender drow that will tell you that she left the Underdark in search for more power and trying to learn from the surface races, since the drow simply are not winning enough. Even though that might not be necessarily true. Mechanically, she is a ranger seeker that thrives on teleporting people around and making them miserable.
Mostly our allies.
I'll probably do both directions as Rim and the motive for adventuring. Just first question, did I correctly understand you that the transition to the other dream literally begins through a warm friendly light? A vision of warm friendly light? Well, in that case, for the dream it's relatively easy as she would interpret that as some sort of... What happened to the channel? I just got some message. She would interpret the light as in a dream as some sort of a message from an emanator and those and thus grasp at it pretty much reflexively. As for her general motives for adventure is that she strives to do good deeds in the name of her god and help people around the world. And helping people around the world is made quite a bit easier by sticking around with the guild. Or other people around different worlds, even.
As if we are going around to help people.
Of course we are. Mechanically, she's a Hexblade / Paladin. Morning Lord. She does stuff with radiant damage, which is quite obvious from her being a Morning Lord.
Thematically, she was initially a priestess of Minotaur. Then got bitten by a vampire, fell from grace, but rejected vampirism and managed to redeem herself more or less.
Cool.
And that's it.
Elfros, you're next.
Sure. So Elfros would assume in his way that the glowing light is clearly a +5 radiant weapon. That's the next thing on his shopping list. It's glowing and it's just out of reach. That sounds all very suitable. So Elfros is 6'1". He's got long blonde hair. He wears a flowing robe that seems to vary in colours depending on the time. Yeah, of course. It's bedecked with various stars. I have played this adventure. It was with Hanan, who has now been retired.
Gotcha.
So his robe with the different stars seems to vary. During the day, it's a pale, almost white, almost invisible. During the night, it kind of deepens to a dark blue, bedecked with pinpricks of light. His reason for adventuring is that he is a member of the Fellowship of the Golden Flower, which is an obscure elvish sect or group who are entrusted by Corlon to go and recover lost elven relics across the plains and return them to the Great Museum.
Gotcha. Belongs in the museum.
Exactly.
All right, Conway, you're up.
Conway is likely in a meditative state when he's working. Mechanically, he doesn't meditate, but thematically, he probably doesn't ever really sleep properly. Instead, traveling out into the gardens of the guild and sitting, perhaps in a pond or some sort of nearby pleasant lake, where he will try to reconnect with nature after some particularly harrowing adventures. Sort of coursing around him as ever, sort of jumping and flowing, is his dragon spirit companion Shadow. And as he closes his eyes to sleep, Shadow will sort of nuzzle up under him. Shadow is now a distinctive white rather than the red currently pictured. And when he closes his eyes, Conway will see a strange, you'll see the silver flame of the religious order that he's recently come out of an adventure defending on the world of Eberron. But he'll see that sort of coated in the chill of winter, as if it is somehow grasped by something else.
Cool.
Well, that doesn't bode well.
So, as you guys see this light coming forward, the light actually changes and starts to look like a whole series of lights, a multitude of. Hopefully I've done this correct, because it's been a while since I've done this map, and it always looks really weird on the DM layer. Ideally, you can see there are two icons on the map, and then a bunch of blue dots.
Yep.
Yeah.
Excellent. So the light starts to come forward, and you can see that it actually is two brighter pinpoints of light. One which has a kind of warm sun-like glow, another that has a cooler sort of soft white glow. So this is a lot like the sun seen through clouds, and this is a lot like the moon on a clear night. And then between it are dozens.
Are you pointing in the wrong way?
I am indeed. So this one is the warm kind of sun-like light. This one is the brighter white, like a moon on a clear night. And between the two, you see at first dozens, and then hundreds, and then possibly thousands of smaller little lights that, as you get closer and closer to the depiction of whatever is happening here, you get the strong impression that this is individual people. This is individual something, as some of them move around through the area. Those of you guys that, so you would recognize this symbol as being the symbol of Pelor. If you are a servant of a monitor, then it's a monitor. You know, this is the deity of the sun god, and then this is the deity of the moon god. This is Saloon. As you guys start to draw close, you see a change.
Shit, black hole.
That doesn't look...
There you go. So you get this this wave like coming in from the ocean of this tide of darkness with a lot of kind of purplish light sort of swallowing up things at the edges. The wave comes in and crashes over things, and you see dozens and dozens of those little blue lights get winked out in an instant. And then the longer the darkness stays, the more the blue lights start to fade. The blackness recedes, and you see the bright light of a monitor glow brighter and brighter, as if it is trying to resist the darkness. As you continue to draw closer, a second wave comes. And this time you see the light of a monitor fade. The light around this icon completely fades away. And starts to emanate an aura of sort of menacing purple darkness. And then you see this light up here, the cold white light, diminish and get smaller and smaller until only a pinpoint remains. And you feel your body drawn towards that light as a rush comes over you, and a bright light appears, like as you kind of zoom into that light, a bright light suffuses your vision, and you find yourself standing.
Well, that's some freaky ass shit.
Do we get any sense of the origin of the dark waves? Like, are they somehow related to another specific deity as the symbols were?
If someone would give me a religion check.
Don't be silly, I'm a divine character. I don't know anything about religion.
Truth.
I'll try. Is that enough?
I did entirely. I'm sorry. So, the Avenger has no idea what's going on. The Hexblade, on the other hand, has seen darkness before, especially as an opposing force. And the black and purple motif is something that is pretty reminiscent of Char. And since Char is a direct opposing force to Saloon, it is a reasonable assumption to believe that there might be something to do with the goddess Char. So as you guys appear, you guys can be in any square adjacent to the fountain. So as the light kind of fades, before you can even see anything, you can hear the cries of villagers. There's some sort of fire going off in the distance. You hear some crashing, like wood being broken. And then as your vision clears a little bit, you find yourself in a graveyard. This central fountain has a winged figure, an angel-like figure that's about 20 feet tall, a little bit less, that is standing in the middle of this fountain with the wings outstretched. You have the graves that are gathered around, some of which look like they might be disturbed. Then you have these two sort of outbuildings that are out here, although the interior should be hidden. And you have the what looks to be several elven villagers that are running towards the safety of the inside of the graveyard. And you see these creatures coming in, chasing them towards the graveyard. This up here at the top is a church or a temple that is where a lot of the crashing wood sounds are coming from. The edge of the graveyard is this metal grate. Crossing over the grate is actually blocking terrain, although you can fire range attacks through it. Things on the other side will just have cover. These guys down here, the Shadow Brigade, let me turn on the right there, cool. The Shadow Brigade knights are knights in very dark black armor. When they move, they kind of have this shadow that follows through them that seems very solid. On their chest, there is a black dot surrounded in purple, which is the holy symbol for Char. You see the skin render ghouls. They look like they might be gnolls, as they have very heady pelts of fur, but their head and mouth is completely distended, and they don't seem to have any eyes. The wraiths on either side, and that are all around the graveyard, look like very long black figures with heavy cloaks that have an ominous red light glowing on the inside. So, initiative, please.
Everybody gets close to cardboards.
Our friend who is so well versed in the ways of religion. Do you perhaps recognize who the winged statue is of?
I mean, I could try. My religion modifier is lower than yours, though.
Really?
Yeah, it's mine is plus 13, yours plus 14.
I'm higher level. Oh, and of course I'm trained, because I have to be.
All the religious things.
It's an in skill, obviously, from way to find out this.
So I've now had in six rolls four ones and two threes. So I'm gonna try rerolling my initiative because that is a thing I can do. That is more like it.
You think I'll let you reroll perception?
No, reroll initiative.
Oh, are you actually rolling initiative and not perception now?
No, I've never been in I'm a half elf, not a wood elf.
Ah, gotcha.
Then I will use Avengers Readiness to add 5 to that.
Okay.
Because I want to go first, strangely enough.
A question, don't you already have a plus 2 from Anibal? Are you counting that in?
That is a very, very good point, so I don't need to. So I'm at 37.
38,
yeah.
Adjust yourself and then I will rearrange.
Okay, where am I on the list? Ah, here we go.
We just got a plus 2, right?
Yes.
Why is that not saving? There we go. Yeah, adjusted. And we roll initiative, so I shift to that.
All right. So, Elthros, you're up.
Excellent. I shall hope the ghoul.
Okay.
And say that its head would look very nice in the taxonomy section of my museum. I shall. I normally use the yellow.
Well, Hannibal's got yellow, so.
Oh, I see. Yeah, no worries. I will be the Pink Ranger for today. I shall move up to there. I shall use Twin Strike because that is a thing that I do. So that's a crit and a 34.
Yeah, the 34 and the crit both hit.
Okay, so let me give you some damage. 51 plus 21 plus 6. So that's 78 plus radiant plus the two weapon opening.
So striking into it with radiant, you see the kind of shadowy cloak that it carries with it dissipates.
Excellent.
He is now bloody.
Well, that is horrendous rolling on the two weapon opening.
So that is going to miss.
Yep, I assumed as much. So he takes 5 radiant damage on the miss.
Okay.
Which is my level. Woohoo! My level 16 feature was useful. I will action point.
Okay.
Somebody was giving out bonuses. Does that come with action point bonuses too, or is that unrelated?
I'm giving out first turn combat advantage to everyone.
27 AC?
27 AC does not connect, unfortunately.
That's fine. So yeah, I action point and use Twin Strike again, because that is what I do. Action point. Those are some nice rolls. That's another crit. And
dead.
Cool. I will use Holy Blessing to transfer the oath to this dude here.
Okay.
And that is a lot of actions, so I'll be done.
Alright, the Wraith is going to move up, and then it is going to charge after Elthros.
Okay.
So, 23 AC, I assume, misses?
That will miss.
Conway, you're up.
Okay. Well, no. Ophelia, you have a range basic, right?
Yeah, I have a range.
The melee bot is not currently in range. go ahead and take a shot at the knight.
Okay, a shot at the knight. Plus cheek to attack.
Keep in mind that he will have cover from you, so if you want to put that on your side.
I didn't include. So it's 31 versus reflex.
31 reflex will still hit.
I can take 44 radiant.
He's also revealed by radiance.
I'm gonna conjure shadow here. So I thought, maybe one on the ground actually. Yeah, I'll conjure it here 5 foot off the ground, and then I'm gonna move. I think they've probably got that rank held up. Helps some villagers. Then Conway is going to call out to the villagers to gather around the fountain.
You guys, do what you were doing anyway!
Yep. But being told that you're doing the right thing is always very comforting.
I'm sure.
Gotcha. Alright. The Wraith over here goes up to the edge of the graveyard. It looks like it tries to pass through the barrier that's made by the metal grates, and it lashes its hands along the edge, and nothing seems to penetrate. Right then, here does the same thing. Right over here does the same thing as it moves up. And then Hannibal, you're up.
Quick question, Sir Elka and Ophelia, do you want me to bring the Shadow Brigade into the graveyard?
No.
No? Okay.
I would say not, because if we're trying to protect the villagers, then...
Okay.
Yeah, we're trying to protect the villagers.
I'm going to teleport here. Stick a curse on the Shadow Brigade Knight.
Okay.
And hit him with Chains of Levestis.
Okay.
Twenty-seven fortitude
does not connect.
Okay, let me try this then. 32
will connect.
33 radiant.
Okay, he's bloody.
I'm done.
Skin Render is going to come over here, and he is going to tear at this villager. Soroka, you're up.
Wait. Sorry. Oh, shit. I forgot I had my activation. I wish to disrupt his attack on the villager.
Okay.
Twenty-nine AC
will connect.
22 points of lightning damage. He can be teleported 3 squares away from the villager. He takes a -9 to that attack roll if that is blah blah blah. And that's it.
Okay. Soroka, you're up.
Did the villager live?
Yes.
Oh great, okay. I will move here. We'll do a Storm of Blows. First target is this Shatter Grade.
Okay. Soroka, what's your passive perception?
Very low. I think it's an 18.
Okay. Carry on.
I will... Okay, Storm of Blows. Okay. 28 versus AC on the Shatter Grade.
28 AC on the Shatter. Is that with the...
Oh, we have combat advantage, don't we?
You have combat advantage, but he's got cover, so both of those things included.
Still 28, then, because I did not include combat advantage.
The 28 will unfortunately miss.
Dang. All right. I'll shift here and attack the second Shatter Grave.
Okay.
Going to include CA this time. 34 AC.
Yes, that will hit.
16 normal damage, untyped damage, 6 radiant damage, and he's slowed until the end of my next turn if he is undead or a shadow creature.
Is this guy here? Yes?
Yeah.
He dies.
Great. And then the last attack on the Skin Render Ghoul. And I will mark these targets, by the way.
Okay.
41 AC.
Yep.
16 untyped damage, 6 radiant, and slowed until the end of my next turn.
So is it 16 untyped, 6 radiant, and slow?
Yeah. 4 more back to here. I'm going to do a no-action attack. Actually, I won't shift 4 more. I'll just do the no-action attack. So I'll knock him prone. Go ahead and shift back down here.
Okay.
That's Wraith again. Well, 39 AC, and I assume he's dead.
39 AC for 13?
Yeah, 13, untyped, 6 radiant.
Okay.
I'll be done. Oh, yeah, I'll be done.
Sorelka really coming into his own there, just whacking at everything that he goes past.
All right, Shadow Brigade Knight. If he moves away from Shadow, he does provoke, correct?
Correct.
That is correct.
He is going to do so.
Okay. Is he immune to fear? I would imagine so. But he's already going to come out of advantage for other reasons.
He is immune to fear, but yes. Okay.
I do call her.
29 versus reflex will connect.
Oh. Okay, I'm with 20 cold and lasting for some.
If he's moving, he takes 23 for my secondary chains damage.
What's the? Could you link the chains for me? I'm sorry, I didn't see the chains. Well, I didn't see the secondary effect on chains. Target moves for the end of the turn. Okay, so you took 23?
23, yes.
Alright, he is going to charge to here.
If he hits, I'll use strike bonus.
Okay. Uh, 36 AC?
God damn it, that does hit. I have 36 AC at the moment. And that will break my hat.
So, 27 psychic and thunder damage, you are marked down.
Break my hat. Love it.
Then I will use strike back.
Okay.
You're just looking at the first roll because of the Wraith adjacent.
Okay.
Wait, she's a 29?
It's not going to connect.
Yeah. He can take 5 radiant damage on the miss.
The 5 radiant damage is actually going to kill him.
Excellent! Useful features! Ish.
Raid. Charge. Miss.
That will miss.
Misery, you're up. Aaron, you're up.
So, everything seems to be relatively under control. Let's take a peek at the church, right? Can I look through the windows from here?
Yes. What's your passive perception?
31.
No, Benedict, they can't. So, you can be aware of what is going on in the church, at least to some degree.
And the fact that she has dark vision probably helps seeing inside as well.
Which is why I'm revealing the whole inside.
Okay, I guess that from here, I only have a shot at the Shadow Brigade Knight, the skin when they're outside my capacities right now.
You will be able to perceive where they are as you're moving up, so if you want to stop to have another shot at something else, you can. Keep in mind that the windows are closed, so you know, you're going to have to destroy the window on the shot in.
Will that give them cover or something?
We'll give them superior cover, yeah. Because you have to you have to shoot through a window, which is going to be really rough. You can see that there is one villager who seems to be hiding underneath a pew, who is here as the ghoul is stalking towards him. The knight is making his way over this way, kind of charging through stuff. It's kind of ignoring this guy right here. There is a lot of kind of devastation on the inside of this church area. And there's a huge bell that's here that's crashed down.
Okay, if I moved here then, would I be able to shoot both?
Yes, the first one will have the minus 5 on it.
Alright, the first shot will be against the Skinrender one, and the second shot is going to be against the Brigade Knight.
Okay.
I am going to use Wands of Moonlight. But first, I'm going to poison my weapons, so they can just be turned to thunder anyways. Makes so much sense, I know.
Yeah.
You pour some lightning onto your weapon.
Basically. At this point, I think that it's not so much of a poison as it is just a lightning conductor. Sorry, minus 5 on the first one, right? I need to include that in. So, minus 3. 8. 4, 28 and 33 versus DC.
So the 28 will miss, the 33 will hit.
The 28 will miss the Skinrender goal?
It will miss the Skinrender goal.
Ooh. How much of a roll is that? It was a 9. You know what? I'll take it.
I can fix that.
You can fix that?
I did tell you I completely gutted Conway. I'm gonna noble edit that. Okay, well, we tried.
30 will hit.
Sorry, and I forgot to change to reduce damage because I don't want this to be lightning.
Okay.
So this is going to be 6 less damage on each of them, so it's 30 and 33 versus AC, damage, sorry. And they are take that as cold and radiant, and they are restrained save ends.
So it's cold and radiant instead of light. Gotcha.
Correct.
Is that the default damage type for the power?
Yes.
Cool.
Okay. They are restraint events?
Yeah. And you know what? I'm going to... Do any of them seem like they have reach?
The Brigade Knight's got a pretty large sword, but
okay,
you don't know if that's going to be a reach weapon or not.
So on the hit on the Skinrender goal, I am going to activate my my weapon.
Okay.
And I am going to arrange basic at the Shadow Brigade Knight that is now revealed by light, right? And
yes.
This one will be lightning.
Okay.
There it is. For 31 versus AC?
31 AC will connect.
Alright, he'll take...
Actually, it will not, I'm sorry. 31 AC is unfortunately a miss.
Fuck it, I want this to hit, so still re-roll that, because just... I don't want anybody to die right now.
Okay.
While I don't still understand the situation. So, how many stones do we have?
Post in the chat.
So 3 stones extra, so that's a plus 3 extra. Okay. I'm just gonna roll a d20 plus 3. And that should be more than enough.
Yep.
35 points of lightning damage and he can be teleported into there.
Okay.
He's also slowed and cannot shift. And
yep.
I am done.
Slowed, bloodied, restrained, cannot shift. Wraiths continue to not be able to do anything. The Brigade Knight, I just got bad things happen to him. Yeah, he just makes saving throws. It's a sad day for him. And he fails to save and never be restrained.
Excellent.
Ophelia, you're right.
I'm not sure there's still anything that needs being done, to be honest.
There are monsters still around.
Well, most of them are those minions, so I'll just walk over to here. And just use Veil of Light on these guys.
No, I mean, called Purglow. Oh, that's a crit, which means I get a second action point. Nice.
Let's
Does it hit all of them?
1, 2, 3. So you have 4 attacks. The 4th attack is a 29 B-Will, which will hit.
Okay, all of them explode, I assume.
Yep.
And that's it for my turn.
The Scanranger, who is restrained over here. Pretty sure he doesn't have reach. He does not have reach. So he is going to... Oh, I think I might have actually missed a button on this guy. Oh, well. He is going to lash out this long, kind of disgusting-looking kung, and then it flicks around in a circle, spreading blood. Oh, I didn't miss it, actually. Yeah, take that one.
So it's 33 on the villager, 22 on me, or 33 on me and 22 on the villager?
I don't roll against the villagers, so...
33 on me. That's a hit.
Where is the thing? There we go. Villagers bloodied, 14 necrotic and psychic damage. You are dazed till the end of his next turn. Actually, it would have been a 31 will if that matters, because he's restrained. And we'll also fail a saving throw versus restrained. The villagers all run towards the center area. This villager actually doesn't have anyone engaging him, so he's going to do the same thing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. He's going to run to there. Elthros, you're up.
Okay, Cody. Well, I have two stances, and in a horribly metagaming way, I feel that there's unlikely to be more than... I'm going to enter a stance. I'm going to enter the snapping wolf stance. Or I am. Snarling wolf. There we go. Then, that's one minor. Second minor, I'll oath the wraith on the left.
Okay.
And then I'll defining cut the pair of them.
Okay.
Those are horrendous rolls. I miss them. And then 30 AC on the second one.
Miss. Both misses.
Yep. And they're minions, so they don't take the damage.
Correct.
Well, that was very sad. I will be done.
Wraith down here, swing at you.
Okay. As a reaction, obviously I will attack it, but it gets its swing.
Okay, so 9 points necrotic and you're vulnerable 5 psychic as he touches out with a ghostly touch.
That's fine. What thing do you normally use for vulnerable?
The little broken thing. That one.
Okay, human.
It's third okay. Row, yeah. 1, 2, 5th on the
yeah, got it. Left. So I get my MDA, which is...
Is this from some other form of reaction MDA?
This is the Snarling Wolf stance, so whenever an enemy hits or misses you, yeah. I get to do Overwhelming Strike. Another nat 1, because he's got 2 guys facing. But I believe I get to shift. 3 squares. I will scarf the back inside the safety of the graveyard.
You
because
have
apparently these minions are invulnerable to swords.
Yep. Runway, you're up.
Get a dust shadow, conjure it. Yeah, I guess. It's really kind of close up. None of these buttons work with range basics, so Mizu, we're just gonna have to take a shot if you don't mind.
Yeah, no problem.
Cheers.
Alright. That's a large bonus.
Plus 3, plus 5.
Plus 13 at this point. So I guess that hits.
The 44 definitely hits, and it seems to be quite resistant as it regained some of its insubstantial nature when it took its turn.
Oh, okay. I thought it was until my turn. My bad. I'm going to put him there.
Okay.
Then Conway is going to do the honorable thing and physically stand in the way.
Cool.
Where are the... Isra, you're not moving anywhere, are you?
Okay, cool.
Yeah, it would make more sense. Yeah. 5 foot up.
Does Shadow smash Errol Flynnlight through the window?
Yeah, sure. Now a gleaming white dragon.
Excellent.
Wraith continues to be useless. Hannibal, you're up.
Okay. Teleport down there. Stick a curse on the Wraith Boomy. And hit them both with Beguiling Strands.
Okay.
That sounds very wizardly.
It is.
After you told me that you were a warlock. Dirty liar.
I am. 28, 37 will.
Both will connect.
See, I told you they were invulnerable to sword. Gee, magic to deal with.
They're not taking damage. Okay, so the first one...
They won't take any damage at all.
13 radiant, the second one takes 5.
What's the radiant from?
Could have been. Never mind. Not really. All good. Done.
The Beguiling Trans washes over them and they don't seem to care.
Even the curse damage.
The curse damage is the same type, I assume, and so one of the wraiths will be bloodied. Looks like it's having a hard time keeping itself together. Anything else, Hannibal?
Nope, done.
The skin render is slowed, prone, languishing on the ground. It is going to crawl charge at Conway.
Sure.
He's just going to crawl and then crawl charge? Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, that's fine. Conway is fine with being here.
Minus 3 for the mark.
Right, so minus 3 for the mark, plus 1 for the... Hang on. Yes, that is correct. That is the correct number.
Okay, now I will connect.
So 24 points of damage, and he can't actually slide you anywhere. Well, he can. He can slide you there, I guess. And then he will action point and strike up at you and miss horribly.
Correct.
Which would have been one less. So that's it for him. Strelka, you're up.
All right. Can I go through this window that Misery's in front of?
Yeah.
Great. I will move into the church. There. And I'll do a passing attack versus target as the skin render ghoul. Can we enter these squares with the fuse in them?
They're difficult terrain.
Okay, great. Their restraints, so they're offering CA, I believe.
Correct.
35 AC.
35 AC will get the job done.
That's 25 damage, 6 of which is radiant. He's slowed until the end of my next turn.
Okay.
I will shift to there and attack the Brigade Knight. I'll also mark them.
Okay. I assume you're actually shifting next to people, not attacking them from like 5 squares away.
I'm attacking them from 3 squares away with reach.
Okay.
I'm not shifting next to anyone.
Gotcha.
35 AC.
35 AC will hit.
That'll be 23 damage, 6 of which is radiant, and slows the creature until the end of my next turn. I'm also going to throw some back damage in there for an additional 9. Minor action, I'll turn in substantial, and I'm done. I mark both of them.
Okay, I'll do that if it matters.
Cool.
Wraiths come up and stand glowering at the edge of the graveyard, trying to slash him with their weapons and seem unable to pass through the barrier. Misery, you're up.
Oh, right. They would have... Okay, just checking. They would have been pierced by light, right? First I get the saving throw, so let's try to get that first.
Yes, both have been revealed by radiance.
Okay, no longer dazed.
You have this while you're just at it. I'm a different kind of warp.
Oh.
Dude now.
Okay.
You're the real kind of shaman, though.
I am.
Now I'm going to rapid chat over this one. Targets. Bonus to attack. Yeah, because restraint. So 29 versus AC and 32 versus AC.
So the 29 AC on the Skinner goal, is that the?
I didn't declare them, so it's whatever you want.
Yeah, yeah. So 29 on the knight and then 32 on the goal. Sorry, rapid shot's the first. So the 29 will miss the knight and the 32 will hit the goal.
All right, I'm going to inevitable shot that since I missed. And the ghoul is still alive, right?
One second. Damage... my brain's not working. Is the damage 41? Yeah, the damage is 41?
Yes. No, sorry, 42 because he's a 32.
The ghoul dies.
Oh, then I don't use inevitable shot as there are no targets.
I would think you might have saved.
Yeah, I'm dead, I guess. So, Shadow Brigade
Knight? Brigade Knight is still restrained and has all these sort of things on him and has literally nothing that he can do to get out of being restrained and being sad. Ophelia, you're up. I'll roll saving throw.
Okay, I'll teleport over here. Does this guy have cover from me? Since it's this looks like Gates.
I'm sorry. You say this guy. You didn't point, or I didn't see the point.
This guy.
The gates are open.
Yeah, I rushed through.
So yeah, he has no cover, right?
Correct.
I'll then Eldritch Bolt him. Unfortunately, I don't have combat advantage.
Okay.
I assume that murders him.
It does.
I will use that to teleport over here. And then I will action point with one of my two action points.
Okay.
And I'll charge this guy.
Okay.
Don't assume my second. Don't have any bonuses. Something like this.
Yes.
Okay, that's it for me.
So the elven villagers continue to make their way towards the center. There is no reason to continue this combat at all. So I'm going to go ahead and call this here. Probably run more towards the middle.
Wow, these went incredibly smoothly. That was
great. I would say that was a lot less scary than it was last time.
The Radiant Mafia had a good time in the graveyard.
Yeah.
So, as you guys kind of finish off the wraiths as they continue to flow in, you can see that outside of the graveyard, about 15 feet outside of the graveyard, everything kind of fades into a mist. Like, all the colors are a little bit blurred outside. It's really hard to see anything further than about 15 feet away from the graveyard itself. And you can see that the villagers are all, looking at you all in a state of awe.
Well, that's the first time an elf ever looked at me that way.
Well. Oh,
man. I mean, I did, but I still managed to hit six times on an Avenger, which is...
I know, it's so sad that you killed a guy from full health who was insubstantial on your first turn.
I am
you
over-level.
Poor, poor baby.
I am over level.
You poor, poor baby.
I don't know that Conway is actually adventured with anyone in this party.
I've adventured with everyone except Conway.
You remember Conway, but it was probably Onasha.
So, the villagers are gathered around you, are gathered around the fountain, several of which are holding holy symbols. And a couple of them are looking at the fountain, but most of them are looking at different ones of you guys, with this sense of awe in their eyes.
I approach one of them and, you know, greet them as, I mean, what time of day is it? Is it like night, I guess?
It's kind of hard to tell. It's fairly dark, but, when I say 15 feet away from the graveyard, it goes dark. That includes up. So, seems to be night.
Do the holy symbols seem to be dedicated?
Saloon. They're holy symbols of saloon.
I say, good evening, good sirs. We seem to have arrived in the nick of time.
You what language do you say? Say
by undead monstrosities. Oh, what language? Common?
So, one of them, kind of, the one that you approach nods to you. And says, it back in Elven. Do you know Elven, Hannibal?
I do not.
So
I do.
I do.
So those of you guys that know Elven, the villager that Hannibal's speaking with will kind of kneel down, avert his gaze, and say, the Silver Stars will always serve thee. We thank you for your aid. We were afraid that none would survive.
What the hell is a Silver Star? Anybody know?
I don't know. It sounds like something religious to me.
It sounds like something related to Saloon.
The words of the Moon God.
Let me see what let's see
if I know something about the Silver
Star. Yeah, I was about to say that.
Oh, I know meeting this here about Silver Star.
So, Silver Stars are the priests high servants of the of Saloon. I think Saloon and Sehanin are the same deity.
Yes.
So,
yeah.
Yes.
It's like the first place star you get is made of gold, and the second place star, that's the silver one.
Yeah, but the first place star is, you know, had bad problems. You guys saw it in the dream.
Yeah, true.
I would tell the party, be like, friends, any ideas how we got here exactly? I remember the dream.
Elfros will raise his fingers and go, magic.
Yeah, I suppose that's actually my field, isn't it? Give me a second. So, Conway would like to try and work out how on earth we arrived at this place. And how he's been seemingly pulled across worlds. somehow.
So, as you kind of expand out your senses, you can tell that there is some form of illusion surrounding each of you. Once you know that it's there to kind of look for it, you can sort of tune into it and see what the villagers are seeing. While you guys, to each other, look relatively normal, in the eyes of the villagers and the eyes of anyone else who would be looking at you all, you look like angels that are made out of, like, alabaster, like white stone.
So we're basically discount angels.
He's like, friends, I don't know how you feel about stonework, but I believe we look like angels of Serhulun.
When you say stonework, are we becoming weeping angels?
I don't know, don't cry.
In fact, we kind of look like, and then he just points to the statue.
So, when you point up towards the statue, you hear this sort of stone-on-stone grinding sound. And the statue turns to look towards you and nods its head. As it does, you see small cracks start to open up around where the eyes and mouth are. And a voice comes through. Each of you all know that she's not speaking different languages, but you hear what she's saying in your native language. It even sounds like someone who's from your hometown, like the phrasing and the terminology that she uses sounds like someone that you grew up with, that you, maybe a family member or someone else close to you. And when she speaks, she says, "The disguise was necessary. I apologize for the abruptness with which I brought you here, but my children needed some to defend them, and I could not spare the strength." She sort of gestures to the elven villagers that are around, and as soon as she started talking, all the elven villagers sort of averted their gaze away from the fountain.
I feel I would ask what was the meaning of the vision in the dream, especially the part about Emanator and falling in the darkness.
So she turns to you and says, "High Moon is under attack. Many things have already fallen. This is one of the last things to stand against the maelstrom." She sort of gestures out that towards the left hand side, towards the west, and says, "It is somewhat a favor that the means that I needed to bring you here with does not allow you to see what has befallen the city itself."
Gary, can you please repeat what was the name of what has fallen? That part, I couldn't think how that it was.
High Moon has fallen to the maelstrom. I'll
type it out. High Moon. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so if we need to deal with the maelstrom, I think we need to call up one of the Shade Princes.
Elthros takes 20 metagaming damage, which then makes him the most damaged person from that combat.
I think I didn't really take 20 damage. Yeah, slightly more. I took 26 damage.
Okay, still the most damaged person from the combat.
Well, that's what I get for Leroy Jenkinsing into things.
So, question: Are we taking a short rest, or
yes, you can take a short rest.
I kind of already had.
I mean, have we finished the conversation with that king? Because I have a few questions for him.
Go ahead.
So, my first question is, I mean, the invite to a hunt was all good and all of that, but why should I bother helping one of the Seldavin?
Why should you bother helping one of the what? I'm sorry?
One of the elven deities, basically.
Because you might get paid.
She smiles and says, "The time for our infighting, for our petty differences, is soon to be at an end. You do not have to help me, but they would appreciate it. And at the end of things, we are all living, mortal. Or you are all living, mortal creatures."
Why did you pick us?
She shakes her head very slowly and says, "I did not really pick you. I merely sent out a beacon, something to call those who would answer."
Huh.
Have we heard of the Maelstrom before? Do we have any idea what it might be?
If you want to give me a history check, you can do so.
Sure.
Oh, history is something I like.
I just flat out asked her, what's the source of the Maelstrom?
I'd say the Maelstrom is pretty apparent, to be honest.
Yeah, the thing with the Maelstrom is that it has not been seen in a very, very, very long time. So your knowledge of the Maelstrom is much more likely to be from historical record of what happened rather than the origin of it. However, you are going to be getting some of the other pieces. In this timeline, it has been a very long time. So let's see, you've got a 13, which is not the higher number, so 28 and 32.
I got 32.
Pretty certain that both of one of them is above RDC. So, Hannibal, you are aware that the Maelstrom is the name of something that has not happened in a couple of hundred years, but it's basically a storm of dark aberrant energy that drains and destroys specifically divine energy more than anything else. But it completely destroys whatever it touches. It is this darkness that is dark even within the like areas like the Shadowfell and the Perpetual Night. It is something that is out from outside of reality that comes and just sort of tears its way through. And things that are destroyed by the Maelstrom are not just killed and then sent on to their gods as per usual. They're completely obliterated and the remains of their bodies and souls are added into the strength of the Maelstrom.
Do you know where it comes from?
It comes from the outside.
Like the far plane?
Yes, from the far realm.
Cool. Why, can we find out why it's been, why it has started up again now?
A history check will not give you that. Previously, you know that there have been some, the last time it was used was a mad deity that used it. Basically losing and decided to use this as a last-ditch effort.
Okay, serious stuff then. Let me try another check then.
And I apologize if I missed this already, but I'd like to ask her, how is Palor involved in this? That was the symbol that was washed out completely in the dream.
So, she says, High Moon is a servant, is the holy city for the elves. The two twin lights, one in darkness and one in the light, are the centerpieces for the worship and pilgrimage here. So basically, oh, okay. There's two major temples in this city. One of them is to Saloon, and the other one is to a monitor or Palor.
Oh, right, fair enough. So this is the one, if I recall correctly, to Saloon.
Yes.
Is the other church under siege like this one is?
So you see her turn her head to kind of to look above you off in the distance, and she says, "Unfortunately, I believe that is already lost. But they have taken the points of power there and are using it to feed the Maelstrom powerful corrupted energy. While the temple itself is lost, it is not completely destroyed. I need to go back into the Maelstrom to fight against some of the Death Titans that are making their way into this reality. If," and she kind of looks over towards Misery, "you would be able to set aside what differences we have, I would much appreciate the Maelstrom being weakened so that I may be able to fight them on more equal footing."
Well, on my mind, that's okay. I just might ask for something a little unreasonable later.
So she smiles and you see more cracks sort of form in the area around her face and the longer shoulders, and says, "Should I survive, I will give you what aid I can."
We are called upon once more to be a light in the darkness. How fitting. You see Conway sort of glow this same silver light. I find it more comfortable to be a darkness in the light, but
I thought you were playing hard for a minute, and I was like, you're a light in the light too, so.
So
Alphonse's sword will begin to glow as well.
The statue will kind of send a little bit of its light flowing out from it, and tells the other villagers, drink from the fountain, and you will be safe, at least what sanctuary and peace I can offer you. One of the guys that was Hannibal, one of the elves, comes up and hands you a necklace of prayer beads.
Like the actual item or you know, nice stuff?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
And yeah.
Let's make sure this elf takes a double drink because he got touched.
So as the elves start to drink from the water, you see the one that was injured, the wounds close on his body, and they all drift off into a deep sleep.
That's probably for the best.
Yeah, that's probably better than this.
So as kind of the statues there kind of watching over them as they drink from the liquid and fall asleep, you can see more and more pieces of her body are starting to crack and flake off. And she turns back towards everyone and says, there is an item here, something giving me strength, something allowing me to draw others, and it will not be of any use anymore. She sort of gestures towards the base of the statue in the fountain and says, if you need it, take it. But if you can help stop the maelstrom or slow it down, I would appreciate it, as would all of those that understand the battle that is currently happening.
I feel I'd probably ask, what is the item that she offered us?
So,
is it,
pick it out.
What is it supposed to be?
Dig it out, wasn't it like under her statue?
So
yeah,
what
is it supposed to be?
She will take a step back and she dips her hands into the stone and pulls out from the kind of stone pedestal that the statue's on, a mace, and then hands it towards you. It's a crusader's weapon.
Plus.
I think it's a plus 3 of this AL, but I don't remember.
We need to repair the building. Would that help stop the maelstrom in any way?
It is a plus 3.
The prayer beads are plus 3 likewise, I guess?
Yes. Well, she offers it to you anyways. Whether you do not take it or not, is completely beside the point.
So these elven villagers that have been drinking of the fountain, do they seem to have a leader?
The one that stepped forward to talk to Hannibal was the leader that gave away the prayer beads.
Okay, we'll give him the mace and say that he should look after the others.
Okay. After drinking the water, he'll place his back against the fountain and sort of curl up with the mace between his arms and his legs, and sitting cross-legged, and then pass out.
Well, hopefully its glow will deter any nasty wraiths from going near him.
And I wasn't trying to ignore you, Soroka.
I know. There's a lot going on here. I get it. Yeah.
So Saloon turns and says, I do not believe that the time and effort it would take to repair the consecration of the church would be time better spent here rather than going to stop what is happening with the maelstrom. So basically, cool. Yes, doing something here at the church will help, but she thinks your time would be better spent going to the other church.
Yeah, I'd like to kind of pursue that. And what is that opportunity cost then? What is the hurry?
You see more little flakes kind of fall away from her, and she says, "This is not who I am. This is a representation of me sent here to help explain what is happening. I am currently within the maelstrom fighting. The longer I fight as I am, the weaker I become, the closer I see death.
See, now would have been a good time to say, let's take a short rest, guys.
Well then. Time to move.
So, anyone have anything else that you always want to say to the to Saluna's avatar, or anything you guys want to do in the graveyard?
It doesn't seem like an opportune time for small talk, so not really.
Charge!
I think we should hurry before it's too late.
Yeah, as if Mr. Taz.
I do care now. Not thanks to these elven villagers, mind you.
Give me 1 second. So, as you guys make your way across the town, you see that in the streets, there are several of those ghouls, as well as a couple of the knights that have been struck down. The entire city itself is engulfed. It looks like it's been engulfed in battle of one sort or another. Although it looks like most, if not all, of the battle has stopped before you started into the city. Buildings are on fire, that sort of thing. Some things, some areas have collapsed. You see lots and lots of elven guards wearing very similar uniforms that are dead in the streets. You see dozens and dozens of those ghouls, and then even more, like twice as many. So you see maybe 30 or so of those ghouls throughout going through the village, and then you see 80, 100 gnolls that are covered in these symbols, most of which look like these symbols of Shar, that are dead and piled around the fallen villagers. As you make your way through the village itself, you can see off in the distance, even before it kind of gets into range, where more than 15 feet kind of outside of your little area of perception, just kind of falls away into a haze. You can see this temple. And it's on the hill, and it's pulsing with this bright purple light. And on the far side of the temple, you see this swirling tornado of black that looks like it's a tornado that's sitting on the ground at about a 45-degree angle, heading off into the hazy distance.
That is an impressive storm.
Well, are you going to stand here and look at it? We should just get into the damn thing so we can get our rewards.
So, you guys make it to the edge of the graveyard. Not graveyard, sorry. Edge of the temple. Looks like the temple is mostly intact. However, there are obvious signs of damage, and when you guys see back this way, ideally where I'm on the right layer, on the back end of the temple, it's way up here. Actually,
I think you're on the wrong map.
There we go. Now, ideally, you guys can all see the temple.
Yeah.
Sort of, yeah.
Well, we can see the outline thereof.
So the back end of the temple. Try to. The parts that I left hidden on the map, as far as in the fog of war, are the parts of the map that are at a 45-degree angle with the maelstrom sort of flowing. It looks like it's coming both in and out of this temple. So there are these swirls of purple energy that are coming from the temple itself, and then there are these swirls of black energy that are spiraling into the back of the temple.
Gary, sorry to interrupt, but I think that not everything is covered as you planned, because the only thing on Fog of War is the temple itself.
Right. Yes?
Well, the northernmost part of the map is, too, like the northern three squares.
Yes.
Okay, I thought it would be more. Never mind.
Yeah, so it's just the back end of the temple. So this whole area, well, that's not what I want to do. This whole area of the temple back here is where the darkness is. And it's coming into, you can see this part of the temple here is the focal point of that energy.
So are the we see that even though the doors shut?
The doors are closed, yes.
Of course. Curses.
But we see that probably looking at the roof or whatever.
Yeah, you can see the maelstrom over the roof. Like, it's enormous. It's the size of a tornado coming out of the back of this temple that's up on a hill. I've had two people ask me that they for a minute to be right back. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a five-minute break in real life. So when it's whatever time zone you're in, 35, we'll go ahead and reconvene.
Okay.
I think we should cunningly open the doors before he calls for initiative.